Los Angeles.
The Film Talk with Gareth Higgins and Jet Lo.
Greatest artist of the 20th century? Alfred Joseph Hitchcock.
Once Upon a Time in America and It's a Wonderful Life are the same film.
Curse of the Cat People is as good as Wizard of Oz.
Perfect triple bill. I Am Love, Godfather, and The Leper.
Andrei Rublev, best film ever made.
The Fountain is a masterpiece.
I wish I had seen the film that you just described, but that's not the film.
Crystal Skull is three times better than anybody says.
Herzog versus Ferrara. Two words, cage match.
I could never love anyone. Didn't love Field of Dreams.
Did we even see the same movie?
Hey there, folks, and welcome once again to the Film Talk. It's one big conversation on the art and meaning of movies, brought to you in regular installments. I'm Jet Lo.
I'm Gareth Higgins. The conversation never ends. It's episode 216, a very special episode, a short chat with the great Norman Lloyd, who's appearing tomorrow night, the 8th of November, or tonight, depending on when you're listening to this, to celebrate his 98th birthday. Norman Lloyd, you know him, headmaster in Dead Poets Society, senior doctor in St. Elsewhere, but more importantly, actor with Orson Welles and in Hitchcock's films. He's stopping by the Egyptian Theater in Los Angeles on the 8th of November for a selection of episodes from Alfred Hitchcock Presents, some of which he directed.
Gareth, this is the guy, dear listeners, I'm sorry to interrupt you in case you don't know, this is the guy hanging off the Statue of Liberty.
In Saboteur, that's right.
This is the guy we're talking about. This is the guy that gets killed and disappeared amongst the papers, the poet, in what is arguably the greatest production of Shakespeare in U.S. history, Julius Caesar, or just Caesar, by Orson Welles. This, wherever you look in film history, he is there. And now on our show, so.
He's on the show, he's a delightful man.
Thereby validating our program. Let's get right into it, our short chat with the legendary and so talented and pleasant to speak to, dare I say, Norman Lloyd.
Well, Norman Lloyd, thank you very much for joining us. You're welcome to the show. It's an honor to have you. Let me say this. We're recording this one day before your 98th birthday. So how does it feel to be coming of age?
Well, I feel okay. I just couldn't get a tennis match this morning because these guys that I play with are getting very lazy and they're growing old. I'll have to look for much younger types.
Maybe some of our listeners will be tennis players. Well, happy birthday to you all the same.
Well, thank you very much, sir. I appreciate it.
You're presenting tomorrow night at the American Cinematheque at the Egyptian Theater five episodes of Alfred Hitchcock Presents, some of which you're in and some of which you directed. And I think the obvious question for younger film critics like ourselves who have great admiration and love for Hitchcock's work is he's become an iconic figure, a legendary figure, almost superhuman. There's a lot of mystique around Hitchcock, but
absolutely.
I want to ask you...
And he deserves it.
That's the question. Why do you feel he deserves that mystique, and what was he really like to work with?
It was a dream to work with him, because you're working with a master, and it was all so easy. He was a natural. Inside his head was a reel of film. As a consequence, when you work with him, you brought such confidence, such knowledge, that what he said was right. And he had this great eye. He had a very particular way of telling a story, the ideas of suspense and humor and romance. This mixture, this rare mixture. He had this greatest of all things which the great ones have, which is they, within themselves, have a story. And they bring their story to the script, whatever the script is. And he had that so that the word or the phrase, the Hitchcock film, became a phrase all through our profession. A Hitchcock film is almost like a Renoir painting or something. It's that definitive, that famous.
All of Hitchcock's films, even a frame, if you look at a frame from any of his films, even going back to the silent days, they're instantly recognizable as Alfred Hitchcock constructions. You know, he's been so talked about, and has defined so much of what we call film grammar today, Norman. Are there any qualities of his, do you think, are underappreciated or not talked about as much as you would expect them to be?
No, I think he was fully appreciated on every level. The mixture of suspense, humor, and the surprises he had, the twists, All of those have been fully appreciated. The interesting thing is, imitated. They have been imitated, but no one has been able to get the mixture as he got it. He got it solo, just like he could do it. And no one else, though they try to imitate it, and you have references when you read reviews of pictures, oh, it's a Hitchcock film, or it's a film such as Hitchcock would have loved to have made, or whatever. It's never a Hitchcock film, though. That mixture was within him, his personal story, which was so tied up with England and the time and the war and all that kind of thing.
Norman, then next question to me, the one that rises to the surface is, other than the ones that you were in, what's your favorite Hitchcock film?
Well, of course, if I said Saboteur, you'd think I was prejudiced.
You're allowed to be prejudiced.
Hold on. Do you keep watching it and just hoping that someday Fry is going to be able to get off of the Statue of Liberty?
Hitchcock films, they're all, in a funny way, different, but the same. That is, the area of suspense of something in the fate of man hanging over them. So you got different kinds of stories. But you had, again, if I may go back to what I said about Hitch, his shadow over the whole thing. And so when you say favorite Hitchcock picture, I really have no favorite other than watching myself constantly in Saboteur. But there are the other pictures are quite wonderful. Shadow of a Doubt is a marvelous picture and interesting in its... in its showing of a small town in America at that time, and showed a social aspect of Hitch that he got into the picture.
Now, you've worked with Hitchcock on a couple of films for theatrical release, films like Saboteur and Spellbound, but then you also worked intimately with him on the show for television, Alfred Hitchcock Presents.
I did that for 8 years.
Was there, would you say, a marked difference between his production style for the movies and the style for television?
Well, because there were so many of them, you know. When I started on the series, we used to make 39 a season.
Wow.
Because we started on them, we had a greater variety of story than the films. But the films also had their own special thing. I mean, we didn't, on the television show, make any picture like Psycho. That he only made in the feature, that kind of picture. We did scripts with comedy and romance and still with suspense and covered areas perhaps that all the pictures didn't cover. Although I really think he covered them all when as I talk to you and think about it, because he would do a picture like Psycho, then he'd do... picture like Vertigo, and then he'd do a picture like Suspicion. They were all so different, and yet the same, if you know what I mean.
Well, as you say, that can't escape your own story in some sense. So his story, he himself, was in all of those films.
No, exactly so. You've got the point. Yes, sir.
Your career, Mr. Lloyd, has lasted so long.
Well, it's interesting. This year is my 80th year in show business. I started in 1932 with Eva LeGallien, who was a theater star and had her own repertory company in New York City. In 1932, I was 17, just about to become 18, and I've been going ever since.
It's interesting at this point that you have had such a lengthy, storied career that there are now films out in which other people are playing you. Because you have lived such a dramatic life.
Yes, and I disapprove of all those performances.
Really? So, for instance, well, I look at something like Mean Orson Welles.
Hated it.
Was Joseph Cotten really like that, Norman?
Joe Cotten?
Yes.
No. And neither was I like that. Some guy playing me was absolutely not even a cartoon. I wish he'd been a cartoon. It had nothing to do with me. Nothing. So it goes with these new pictures about Hitchcock. I'll have nothing to do with them.
And is that because they're inaccurate or because you feel that someone...
They're totally inaccurate and they make up things that didn't happen. And they create characters. None of the people who play Hitchcock are like him at all. Don't suggest it in their performances at all that Hitch was like. There was a great solidity to him and a kind of... like a massive, slow-moving, inevitable thing about him. And it's in his pictures. And he was a master storyteller, and he knew how to unfold a story, and that was very much part of his personality. He would spellbind you as he told you the story of his next picture. He didn't tell it to you as if it was about a boy and girl who fell in love and they were romantic feeling. He would say, a man walks in a door. He closes the door. He looks over to the right. He sees a pen. He goes over to the pen. It's that specific. It's frame by frame as he tells you a story. And by the way, visually. And he had a saying, which is so true, that if you can tell it, you can shoot it. If you can't tell it, you cannot shoot it. And that, boy, that is so true. That's why you get a lot of pictures now with storylines that are totally muddled.
So you mentioned specificity there about how specific and exact Hitchcock was. And I want to ask you something about specificity. And that is, growing up in Northern Ireland, and I would watch you on St. Elsewhere, and I watched you on Dead Poets Society and was terrified by your blood-curdling portrayal of a private school headmaster. Thank you very much. I always thought that you were English because of the way you speak, and I want to ask you about your accent. And
I'll tell you about that.
Yeah,
most of my youth was I was raised in New York, specifically mostly in Brooklyn, and later moved into Manhattan, but mostly Brooklyn, which was pretty distorted English. I wasn't a D-Dens guy, but my speech was not really good. I came into Eva Le Gallien's Theatre, which, as I said earlier, was a classical repertory company, and as a consequence, she did Shakespeare and Ibsen and so forth, Chekhov. And she said one day, she took me in as an apprentice, and said one day, if you really want to be a member of my company, you've got to learn to speak better. So we were given, and then it was not only me, it was other guys too, I mean, and gals, who were, many of whom were from New York as well as the rest of the country. So she had two actors, one of whom was Canadian, the other was English, and they worked with us on our speech so that we could play in these plays, even though they were small parts, but we would sound like we belonged in the play, and that belonged on 42nd Street. Fifth Avenue. And that is where I altered my Brooklyn speech. And instead of saying coffee, or things of that nature, you'd say police instead of police. One became capable of working in Shakespeare, and I have been, as a consequence, fortunate to do quite a bit of Shakespeare.
You ever slip back into the old accent?
Only if the part called for it, and when I see it, I think it's phony as hell.
Well, on that note, let us wish you again a happy birthday, Norman Lloyd. We hope you're around and acting for many years to come. It's a real pleasure to talk to you and have you on the show, living film history that you are. And I hope the evening at the American Cinematheque tomorrow night is a great evening for all concerned.
I'll be there, Norman, and I can't wait to see the episodes of Alfred Hitchcock Presents and to see you in the flesh, as it were. Thank you again so much for being on the Film Talk.
And thank you for being so kind. Bye-bye.
That was the great Norman Lloyd. Special thanks to both him and the American Cinematheque for facilitating his presence, as it were, on the show. We really appreciate it. And folks, if you want to hear more of our episodes, we've got a great backlog of shows that are not necessarily available to the hoi polloi, to the ordinary public. You have to be a member. It only costs $2.99 a month. Just go to thefilmtalk.com/member. For details.
That's absolutely right. If you want to follow us on Facebook, you can go to facebook.com/thefilmtalk or on Twitter @thefilmtalk. What are we doing next week? I hear you ask, dear listener.
I'm thinking it's going to be that Daniel Craig. The ladies love Craig. He may just turn out to be the new James Bond. We'll see. I don't know. The jury's still out.
But yes, it's Javier Bardem with a strange haircut. Never seen that before.
Might be a wig.
In Skyfall. I think my voice was too high-pitched for that, because apparently it's very dark and sad. But we'll be...
No spoilers, please.
I don't know. I've just heard that. In the meantime, if you want to see something great, go see Cloud Atlas. I saw it again last night. It was even better. It is the new Star Wars.
I second that, but it's a better picture than Star Wars. Folks, don't forget that the Film Talk is a production of Consolidated Operational Services, LLC, which is solely responsible for its content. And on that avoidance of responsibility, I have been, as always, your servant of cinema, Jet Low.
I've been Gareth Higgins. We'll keep talking.
Next week.
Keep talking.
Next week.
Keep talking.